Now we're heading to New York, Brooklyn to be exact, to meet a musician who has many professional roles as a composer, arranger, a producer, and an MC. Let's welcome Jordan Scannella.
Hey, Lars. Thanks for having me today, this morning, this afternoon for you.
Yes, it certainly is. I don't quite know what time of day it is here, but the sun is shining. How's it all holding up in Brooklyn?
Seems to be going okay here in Brooklyn. To be completely honest, I just arrived back here. I have been on tour with a touring production of Hamilton, an American musical, which left January of 2018, sometime around our last conversation. Over the past 5 months, my girlfriend and I have actually been camped out in Western New York in a little town called Frewsburg, which is very much nothing like New York City. There were cows and cornfields across the street. So we've just arrived back in Brooklyn literally in the past week. So I can't be completely the source for how everything's going. There's a lot of dining on the streets, there's a lot of music on the street and in the park, which is nice. Everyone's taking advantage of the warm weather, but there's definitely a sense, there's a little bit something missing for sure, obviously. I mean, as there is anywhere, but New Yorkers' spirits are strong. They seem to be holding up okay.
Yeah, tough times. But we have to thank you as your role as producer and arranger, because you are the main man behind the Fusioned Lovely Day video, which has just been released.
Totally my pleasure and my honor to be able to do that. Fascinating and beautiful experience to witness the talents of all the fusioneers. I'm not sure what the proper descriptor is for us fusion endorsers. I've been calling them the fusioneers, but I forgot to count how many countries were involved. But yeah, I'm really happy with the result.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes.
And I got to do my Paul McCartney because everybody put down their tracks, and then I got to do the bass last, which I don't know if that's, you know, people who know on a lot of those later Beatles records, Paul McCartney got to do the bass last in the studio. So it was fun because I got to take elements of what everybody else did and then kind of apply it in my own playing and how I approached the track. So I cheated, basically, is what I'm saying. So thank you for letting me cheat a little bit.
I don't think you cheated. I was honored to be part of that as well. And I must say that some of the bass grooves you were putting in really made it. Just took it to a new dimension. Very, very good.
The Lars Mullen moments were a true pleasure, I have to say. I'm going to ring your bell. I know you're doing the interview, but it's true.
No, not a chance. I just sat there and did it. Just do it. So, I mean, that was a challenge, but well, we're all about fusion, which is the main theme, but I think you were the actual first fusion artist way back.
In the 2000s, I had done a few different contracts at the House of Blues and Jazz in Shanghai with the Sam Hooper Group. I met Nicole and Amanda at the Shanghai Music Expo, and I got a free bass, and I was walking around with it in a cardboard case, and I was looking to schmooze my way to a gig bag, and I happened across the lovely Fusionistas, and we've maintained an awesome relationship ever since.
Well, you've been touring now for several years in these musicals, these Broadway musicals, The Lion King, and Hamilton. Tell us about those.
Lion King was actually here in New York, and I was only a sub. I got the sub for the great Tom Barney, who bass players may know from his work with Steely Dan and Miles Davis. So that was my first little toe dip into the Broadway world. But with Hamilton, yeah, I auditioned and got the gig with one of two touring productions of the show that our show started, as I mentioned, in January 2018. I'm past patiently waiting, I'm passionately smashing every... It's an incredible show. For those that don't know, it's like a hip-hop meets Broadway musical meets an opera. Unlike the traditional rock band touring phenomena where you go one night to each city, here we would be sitting down in cities for at least 3 weeks at a time, sometimes up to 6 weeks. And actually we were in Toronto, which was supposed to be a 14-week sit before it got shut down.
14 weeks? I mean, that's like moving to a new town for a few months. That's incredible. These are big production shows. How many people are on stage or involved with all the whole team?
The total number of people in our company, including management and wardrobe and technical crew, was almost 70 people. The orchestra was relatively small, I think, comparatively. I think it's 10. Drums, percussion, bass, guitar, two keyboards, and a string quartet. Did I do that math right? I think so.
Is there a need to keep rehearsing? You've obviously got a set list so that changes maybe, but do you have to keep on top of it, or does it just flow?
Yeah. It very much just flows. Just the level of detail that you get, and that's the one thing I tried to embrace with it, because you get into the nuances of the parts so incredibly because you've played them so many times. Note lengths, fingerings, do I slur this one, which is nice because coming from the world of freelance, or you're doing a lot of gigs with a lot of different people, you often don't have that luxury to spend that much time with any one particular set of music. So that I tried to see that as the silver lining of the severe repetition and redundancy of playing a show that much.
Does the content of the set change that much where you have to take several bass guitars with you?
The show is cool like that. Mostly I'm playing a five-string Lakeland, like a five-string jazz bass, for England's own George III, were arranged in a Beatle-esque manner. So the orchestration called for a Hofner. I actually had a Lakeland hollow body, close enough. Again, second Paul McCartney reference of the interview. The Hofner with the pick sound for the King George songs. Then about 30% of it is on acoustic bass, both like kind of pizzicato, like jazzy, groovy stuff, as well as orchestral passages with the bow, with the string quartet, and then some synth bass as well.
You're primarily jazz fusion and all that sort of stuff as well. Was the bass your first instrument, and was that genre of music your first choice?
No, the bass was my second instrument. I started on piano, Suzuki piano, to be specific, and it's interesting because I think at the time I started piano, I didn't necessarily have a musical preference of sorts. Check it out. Don't turn the lights out, don't go in there alone. I can tell you exactly the time I discovered bass. I was in seventh grade, first year of junior high school, and I went to a high school jazz band concert, and I don't know how or why, but just for that show, as soon as the downbeat happened, all I heard was bass. What will be different? Got my bag of new tricks. What will be different when you run with old clicks? the foundations musically and harmonically laid by piano have been invaluable in my bass playing, and I've come back around to playing more piano now and getting into synthesizers and things of that nature. So I do say that piano, probably no matter where you go, is always a great foundational starting instrument because it's so visual and understanding of it. So I think that was huge, whether or not I realized it at the time or not. But yeah, that's how it went.
Yeah, that's right. Definitely the piano. And we've talked before in other interviews, and you've told me you went to the School for Creative Performing Arts and several stages of the Berklee Colleges, all the demi, semi-quaver, proper stuff. Must have been invaluable for working in orchestras.
Going to that School for Creative and Performing Arts, as you mentioned, in high school was really huge, just because, you know, I was, like many, an idiot as a teenager. And so if I was left to my own devices, I'm not sure how much practicing or playing I would have done. I was much more interested in other extracurricular activities. But keeping it as part of my schooling, playing in the orchestra, playing in jazz band, was really great. I grew naturally just, you know, playing every day in school. And then, yeah, and Berklee, like so many, I thought it was hot. I thought it was the hot stuff coming into Berklee, and was firmly put in my place by the extraordinary talent around me. And so I had to get my act together, and I've basically kept getting my act together ever since then, from being at Berklee, staying in Boston, and then moving to New York City, which is an education of its own.
Well, you're certainly looking very healthy, Jordan. And that brings to a last question. When we talked a couple of years ago in an interview, you were heavily into eating healthy on the road. Burgers and chips, you were saying, out the tour bus window, I'm going to eat healthy. Have you kept that up?
I've probably slipped a little bit since we last talked, and adding a little bit more, like, cheese into the diet, which might account for my COVID-19 pounds that I've added. No, not quite 19. But yeah, I've been trying to keep up with it.
Fantastic. It's been so nice talking to you, Jordan. We have to thank you for talking to us. Thank you for the fantastic production of the video. And thank you for being the first fusion artist. And we probably wouldn't be making this program if it wasn't for you.
Well, I don't know if that much is true, but my extreme pleasure. Thank you for having me, Lars. Thank you for Fusion, for the continued excellence, and so happy to still be involved in partnership with everybody. This is awesome. So thank you for having me.
Bless you. See you next time.
Yeah.